Okay. All right, so we'll call the meeting to order at 7 p.m. Roll call of officers. Dennis is sick. I'm here. Bill's here. Justin, I think he's excused, isn't he?
Yeah, he said he had a dental procedure.
Okay. Olaf, Director Shara Romo, and Dan Spohr's actually moved.
Yes, he sent a letter to Dennis and the supervisor Scribner, resigning. That was an item for later, but we can discuss it still.
So now, we need a motion to approve the, to adopt the agenda.
Can't do that.
Can't do it because we can't.
All we really can do is, Gary, is just.
I'm sorry, you're late, you can't.
Don't forget to mic.
Gail was here, I knew I'd be checking him off. So we can't approve the minutes?
We can do our.
Let's leave.
Is Dennis here?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, so, I guess really all we can do then is just.
We run through the whole thing, we just don't take any action.
Do what?
We run through the whole thing, we just don't take any action. Start with your guest speaker, then have your reports. There you go.
Well, that's what I was just gonna do.
Okay, so.
So our first guest speaker, I don't have it on my.
Rosamond.
Okay. All right, our guest speaker, Rosamond, Community Café, and.
I talked to Cheryl this, this afternoon, she had to stay at the shop. You need to get her to be the quorum, I know, but she has to. Her husband's working down below, she had to stay at the shop there for, on Diamond Street. She gave me a phone number to call. Every time I call the phone number, it says, not taking calls at this time. So I'm not sure what happened to that.
It was in the Rosamond News that they said they were gonna be here, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Well then, by God, it must be true.
But whoever our speaker wasn't able to make it.
I guess not.
Well, I wasn't able to contact whoever, so that, on that phone anyway, there was an email address that we get around.
Okay, well, I'll just move on then. Community leader reports, Kern County Supervisor.
I don't have a whole lot new on Diamond Street. Lorelei and the planning department are still, putting together the funding and getting the donations from the companies for the solar street lights that we're going to put in on Diamond Street.
Okay, I've heard that they were super expensive. Is that right? Or how much are they going to cost?
You know, I don't remember the amount per street light, to be honest with you.
For solar street lights?
Yes. I can't remember the exact amount, but we have secured a lot of donations so far.
How much do we need to raise, I guess, a little?
I really don't know. I don't know the exact per street light, and I don't remember how many in the plant, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that, but I can get it.
And you have another round of renew bid, this stuff coming up?
Yes, I'm not sure the planning department actually hasn't released the dates yet for when that grant process will open up, but they've indicated that it will be soon. They're just working out some of the kinks from past year.
Anything interesting happening in the state of the county? How are we doing with $26 a gallon or a barrel of oil, anything like that?
Right now, as a lot of you guys know, last year our general fund was hit with about a $45 million deficit because the price of oil went from about $95 a barrel to $50 a barrel or so. This year, the price of oil looks like it's around $30, maybe $29 a barrel, maybe $33, but it's going to be about a $35 million hit to our general fund. Only about 3% of the county budget the Board of Supervisors has direct control over. It can go to where they want to. And the challenging part about the general fund deficit is it funds our sheriff's department, our fire department, parks, libraries, you know, just those public safety services, and, those kind of extracurricular things. So it already looks like the Boron substation is going to be closed down, the Buttonwillow Sheriff's Substation, and the prison, or the jail in Ridgecrest will be closed down.
Kern County, the jail right at the courthouse?
The jail in Rich Grant.
What are you talking about?
Well, Rich Grant City has its own jail, I suppose, and...
The county.
County jail is right at the courthouse, you've been there before, right?
No, that's not my district.
I guess the question is, there's rumors where that Rosamond's substation is in danger of being closed too, is that...
I haven't heard anything like that, but that all comes down to Sheriff Youngblood and his decision on what he does with the budget, so...
Okay.
I haven't heard anything.
You're not gonna allow that to happen, right? You're gonna pitch, tell them we're not in favor of that at all?
Okay, I will tell them.
Okay.
I'm sure James and Anton will.
Well, so you...
You know, all of touching on this about the streetlights, Ryan provided me some of the plans for the street lighting there. That work that was not done is roughly a third of $1 million.
Oh, really?
That's correct.
As far as the street lighting, and we're also missing the, we have some money still left in there when they hook up the radio, for lack of a better word, the intercom. There's gonna be like a piped in music along the diamond street, is that right?
I'm not sure.
Or do you, that's the electrical part. That's what I heard, that was done.
Okay.
But,
Wasn't that the electrical brought in to have hookups for the event center?
Well, they were supposed to when we dealt with the county, was developing the whole Diamond Street intercom system, or for playing music or things like that, was part of our design. But I'm not sure if they installed that.
Well, it was in the design, did it make it to where the county actually bid on it, and someone actually promised to do the work?
Yeah, that's how it works.
Could you check?
You just, yeah, I'll check.
Yeah, sound, so basically the sound system on Diamond Street. And then February 4th, was there a hearing? Did anybody attend a hearing in Mojave? The sports supervisors meeting in Bakersfield by going to Mojave, do you know?
Was that, you talked about regarding the library?
Yes.
Yes, I was there at the Mojave remote testimony station. We had, I believe, six people there, and three of them spoke to the board.
And what was the result of the board?
The board decided to, I don't know if you guys remember your speakers, you had the advocates of library enhancement. They were hoping for the board of supervisors to put a 1/8 cent sales tax measure on the ballot to fund libraries. And the other group was kind of looking for Board of Supervisors to do a request for information to find out what the private sector could offer as far as running, contracting out the library service for a private company to help run it. Board of Supervisors decided to kind of continue along both paths. They released a poll among the most active voters in the county to find out their interest in sales tax measure to see if it was something that would pass, because the advocates of library enhancement want that ballot measure to go on this summer.
This summer?
And that would mean on the March 6th, I believe, Board of Supervisors meeting, they would have to vote to put it on the ballot.
If I'm an advocate to pass a tax anywhere, and I've got my choice between June and November, I put it on the November ballot. Why are they advocating for June?
They were kind of, a few of the supervisors tried to kind of ask that same question, and they seemed to think the iron's hot right now. Among voters.
And well, we have a problem. I've never seen anything pass in Kern County unless you have the Chamber of Commerce behind it. And my understanding is the Chamber of Commerce is opposed to a tax.
Bakersfield Chamber has come out against it, and I believe the Tappan Chamber of Commerce has come out against it. I don't recall any other taking formal position.
Yeah, there was no formal position against the road tax. It was something that the federal government was going to match, what, about 6-7 years ago? Remember? And that didn't pass. And obviously libraries are as essential or more as roads.
Well, the board,
you're gonna have opposition and try to pass, I guess.
Well, the board decided to do the poll. The poll results will come back, and they'll basically decide whether they want to put it on the ballot or not. And they also decided to do an RFI, start that process of finding out what the private sector can offer, give the private sector the ability to show the county, you know, what they can do with the library services.
How long a process is that?
I believe the county administrative office said it would take them 3 or 4 weeks to put the whole thing together and release it. basically showing what they want, you know. And then I'm not sure how long the business or the contractors or the whoever wants to bid. I don't know how long it would take or how long they would have to bid. But I mean, it's not a fast process because they have to put their whole bid packet together and say what they would do with the money and how they would make services better.
It would be decided before June.
Well, just going to kind of. I think it's also going to come down to what they decide to do on the March 6th meeting.
Well, the other question is, when does the county supervisors make their budget changes? Like, you know, with the price of oil going down, did they do something special in January, a major adjustment?
Yeah, that was what we were talking about with the sheriff's department. All the general fund funded departments took a 1.5% mid-year budget reduction.
Okay. And then their formal budget they have to pass in June, all right?
Yeah, they have to have, I think that they have their sort of preliminary budgets in June.
And would they?
And they don't usually pass, I don't think, the full budget until the next July.
How does the RFI fit into the general budget? When it passes in June?
I'm not sure. I don't know if it really does. I think it costs too much.
Okay.
I'm really not sure.
Okay, well, that all the timing seems to be set on heading toward June for both the ballot measure and the RFI folks.
Yeah, I'm not sure about the RFI or how long it takes.
Okay.
But just keeping all our options open about the libraries right now.
Okay.
Seeing how much community support there is for the tax measure. If they think there's enough, they'll probably decide to put it on the ballot. If they don't, then they won't. Because it costs, I think, $56,000. Put this 1.5, 1/8 cent sales tax measure on the ballot. That's not something I don't think they're going to do unless they think it's going to pass.
Right.
That's just me speculating.
Right. And certainly if you're going to spend the money,
sure,
November would be a better time to do it if you're going to pass it. Yeah. If, unless the RFI works out to be a better deal, then.
Yep. We're just waiting for more information. That's all we want.
Okay. Anything else?
Nope. Okay. Anybody here from the Kern County Fire Department? Kern County Sheriff's Office.
Sergeant James Anton from the Sheriff's Department. I have two sets of numbers this month, which don't add up, so I'll give you the ones my clerk gave me. She's normally right. We had 841 calls for service and 55 arrests. Our stolen vehicles went down to just one in this for January, so we did have a couple of things at Rosamond High School. I know that I kind of put out in the press. So we had a former student, make some threats to go shoot up the school. We did get to arrest him prior to him making anywhere near the school. It was basically a call for help that he was putting out, supposedly. He wanted some attention, so he got it, but he went to juvenile hall. We also had another call at Rosamond High School a few weeks before that, where someone put on the internet, there was some stuff about RHS. It actually had nothing to do with Rosamond High School, but because people put RHS, people out here immediately thought it was Rosamond High School. It was actually some stuff that was put on here in Florida.
High school in Florida. Yeah.
So, but when stuff like that happens, we do respond to the school. We do have officers at the school, make sure the students are safe, and then go from there and do investigations. So.
And are we fully staffed in Rosamond, or how's that looking?
We're still staffed the same we've been staffed for the last few months. We have 10 deputies, 2 senior deputies, a sergeant. I have 2 vacancies and 1 person I have in leave.
2 vacancies and 1 admin leave. And
and I'm short 1 clerk too. I have 2 spots for clerks and I have 1 clerk, so that's why Rosamond Substation is not open on a lot of Fridays.
And if we wanted to voice our concern about that, we just tell Mr. Rush and see what we can do about it.
That would be more up chain of command over my head, not his.
Donnie Youngblood, the sheriff, took the own budget together, and he decides where his money comes
so
out.
So we used to complain directly about the Young's budget.
That position has been vacant probably for 8 years for cost savings.
Well, the clerk, yeah, but the vacant. Three other positions are not the time for him to be dedicating resources elsewhere, I would think.
Right.
You guys want to put that on the agenda for next time, Mr. Thieman? And is Mr. Youngblood coming to the Sheriff's Appreciation Dinner?
I haven't heard a word.
You're going to be there though, right?
I will be.
And so it'll be a good time to talk to the guys higher up the food chain, right?
I assume Lieutenant Little will be there. I don't know if Commander Beasley or anyone else that is invited will attend.
That'll be a good event for the Vice Chairman to attend, right? The secretary.
It was a nice event last year. It's been a nice event every time I've been.
And it's just $30 a ticket. Okay.
Okay. Anybody here? Thank you, Sergeant. Anybody here from Council on the way to Cole? Rosamond Community Watch.
To let everybody know, our cleanup for February will be this coming weekend, Saturday. We'll be cleaning up along Sierra Highway. Cleanup begins at 8 a.m. Sign in between 7:30 and 8. And just to let everyone know of a community project that we were recently involved with, Willow Springs Speedway is getting up and ready for the new season. There was quite a bit of damage from the recent storm that happened over at the quarter mile paved oval. We went up and helped with a little bit of cleanup. The concession stand that's currently there hasn't been used for several years. They had allowed a motorcycle club to use it for their meetings, and they did a lot of graffiti inside, and it was just in really bad shape. So we spent several hours up there back on February 6th. The concession stand looks brand new. Everything's great. They put new shutters, hinged shutters on the windows so they don't have to be screwed in every time and make it look bad. But everything's looking good. They're going to have at least one, possibly two more work parties before their opening weekend, which is March 26th. As soon as we find out when the next work party is, we'll let everybody know. And we actually had quite a bit of fun up there that day, meeting some new people and helping them get back where they need to be. There was some major damage to some of their other facilities. An entire roof was blown off. One of their security shacks, the wind just toppled it over. All the windows were broken out. The porta-johns were just basically thrown into the field. And there's still quite a bit to do. As Jack mentioned in the previous meeting, one of the telephone poles that is next to the grandstand, it was broken in half and is laying into the stand, took down the majority of their PA system. So there's still a lot more work to be done. And we'll try to let everybody know in case you want to go up and spend a day up there and have fun.
Okay, thank you. Alrighty, anybody here from the Rosamond Community Services District?
Might be somebody here. well, the big news, if you didn't read the paper yesterday, very, very detailed article there. They covered most of all the bases there. But the bottom line is the board voted 5-0 to purchase 240 acres of land in Los Angeles County at 200 Street West and Avenue B8.
How many acres?
240 acres.
210.
210 acres. Okay. Yeah, 160 plus 40 plus 10. That's right. So 210 acres. See, Allison's here to correct me. Wrote the article. 210 acres for $975,000. And that's cash money. And we got a 30-day look on it to make sure there's no environmental problems with the property. It was owned, it's a former alfalfa ranch. It appears, at least from the Google Earth pictures that I've seen. and it has an agriculture well, residential well, it has an old 2,300 square foot home on it, a modular home. Brett and Dawn LLC Solar was the seller, and along with the property came 150 acre feet of water rights in perpetuity. And the idea is, we do have two people who are interested, have expressed interest in getting building permits in Rosamond, and to get the building permits through Kern County, they have to show they have water rights. So now we can say, well, if you want the water rights, we can sell them to you, separate and apart from what we already have. Because in the ramp down, we go down to 404 acre feet of water from 20, we've used as much as 2,900 acre feet in Rosamond, so that's not a 20, that's basically 2,500 acre feet we'll have to make up in a regular year. Of course, you all know we cut back 30% from the year before, et cetera, with our general manager. That's, there were somewhere around 2,300 acre feet we used this year, which, you know, significantly down from 2,900, but still it's a lot of acre feet to make up, which is something we'll have to look at on another day. But in the meantime, if someone wants to build something, it's incumbent on us to make sure we have the water to say, yes, we have the water, we will serve you with water. And it's called a will serve letter, because here it is. All you have to do is come up with the money for the acre feet that we have, and we can sell you. And time is money in many instances, especially in the real estate market. The market is Albert Gatton, I'll defer to him, and he can tell you what how fast houses are turning over here in Rosemont. Did you want to speak about that, Albert, at all? Or?
If you want. As far as the overall AV, there's right around 1,025 to 1,050 homes for sale in the current market. Average market's closer to about 1,600 to 1,800, so we are quite a bit low on inventory. And homes that are priced well are turning over rather fast. Land is still holding its value, which is good. And there's, from my understanding, the new homes over there at Legacy off of 35th and Rosamond Boulevard have pretty much been built out, and there's a waiting list. So there is still a large demand for homes. People are still looking to move to Rosamond from LA County to get away from the higher taxes there. So we are still more desirable area as far as cost is concerned.
And what the community service district has done is made the water available at $10,000 an acre foot, or basically $10,000 a door more, I guess, than in the past. You think that's something that the Legacy Homes, for example, could absorb in marketing their homes to their waiting list? And it's an increase of price, basically $10,000 to cover that.
It's possible, but it really depends, again, on what interest rates do as well. Because the Fed back in December said that they were going to be 0.25% every quarter is what they were going to raise, so it's a steady increase. That would put us back to about a 7 or 8% interest rate, which is a historical average. But housing prices would have to drop generally in order to compensate for the monthly payments that a homeowner would have to take on. So if interest rates go up and home prices go down, it may not be as affordable to build new homes, especially with the increase in water prices, compared to just buying an existing home. So there's a lot going on in that, so it's a little hard to say. If water rates go up and interest rates go up, then it's going to be much harder to build new homes.
So Legacy Homes, I think, is one of the potential buyers that Mr. Smith talked about, the 94 homes. They have 94 lots, I guess, south of Rosen Boulevard around the 35th Street West area, mm-hmm. that they want to need that water for.
So RCSD bought 210 acres for the purposes of acquiring the water rights?
Essentially.
And you said it was 150 acre feet that they pumped in the past? So after adjudication, it's going to be like 40% of that?
I didn't say we are buying 150 acre feet, period, that they were awarded in the adjudication.
Oh, they were awarded 150 acre feet, so that takes into account the adjudication.
Yes, in other words, adjudication says If you look under the, if you go online and look at the AV groundwater adjudication.com, look under Red Dawn, LLC, I think it is, it'll say Red Dawn LLC, 150 acre feet. That's what's tied to the 210 acres that we're purchasing. So that was the idea of behind the purchase.
Are you going to be able to rent out the house or have the farmland farmed or lease the farmland or?
Well, I heard that Gary Thieman was looking for a studio and we could have him move out there. But, yeah, we could rent it out. We could, as far as a farm goes, obviously a farmer, we have to give up farming after about 5 years because then the water rights would be going away. You have 2 years of unmitigated pumping and now they want to plant something. But you know they have to ramp down at the time we have to start using it. So it would be difficult to raise something since most, I guess, even pistachios or almonds take 5 years before the trees are ready to produce. So I don't think it's going to be used for farming. Although it is in an area that there's a nice wash going across the top of it. Maybe it'd be a good area for our own water bank if we can have it. Although we are 6% owner in the other water banks, on the tropic, other areas that are good for percolation are something you shouldn't ignore. So, but that's the big thing we did over there. And obviously, there's a lot of other things that need to be done or working on. We're still working on getting the letter of applicability from the state on the so we can actually get the tertiary water and start distributing it. Lahontan was the first part of the puzzle. The second part of the puzzle is getting the state water people to say, here's your letter of applicability. They came down and met with our general manager last week or 2 weeks ago, and hopefully they're working on getting that done very soon, because I understand that Glendower Park needs the water. Is that right, Brian? And could you check in to see, make sure that they're not holding back on the water for the facility? Because we're going to get that water eventually, I would think, before, at least by June. And I would hope by March. But if they're holding back on that, I understand that they have the ability to plant the grass as long as the county can water it. Right now, the county's just not watering it. And I think in February would be a good time to water, at least to get it planted and get it rolling rather than waiting. Especially since some kids are going to be out playing on it, or they are out playing on it. So, figure out what we can do.
Sorry.
And the other thing that RCSD is working on is getting that taken care of. That's a big thing, and of course, bringing the purple pipe out. If you're interested in the purple pipe, or you know someone who is, Albert and Terry. Make sure they get them, contact us right away so we can get them online, because we're sending out the bids, not the bids, we're bidding for the materials. We're going to be putting the pipe in very soon, all the way out to West Park from Patterson, you know where Patterson Road is. We have an outlet on the other side of the freeway. It's going to run up and over, or over, out and up, I can't remember, to where the West Park is. And likewise, we have a line that's going to run out, I believe, from Sierra Highway underneath the tracks over to 9th Street Park. At least that was the plan that I understood. If you have any other people who want to get online with that, let us know. That would be the time to do it. So I think those two things are enough to work on for now. Do you have any questions about whatever else is going on?
Okay, just we want to... the Rosamond Foundation?
Nothing really new to report. We are having a meeting March 3rd at Rosamond Hills. And that's about all the information I can provide you at this time.
Okay, thank you. Terry, Rosamond Chamber of Commerce?
Yes, the Chamber of Commerce is still working to improve things in Rosamond. The one project that we have going on now is Jed Strange, our artist, is painting a mural on the car wash wall. Maybe take a few more months to do that, and then we're also looking at working on our grant that we had received from the county and start our event center for the downtown area. So we do have to apply for a conditional use permit for that event center, and we'll be working on that this next month. We have about 70 members, and we're working on opening the chamber and keeping things going.
Thanks.
Thank you, Darren. Anyone here from the, let's see, Rosamond Youth Football and Cheer? Mojave Chamber of Commerce? Southern Kern Unified School District?
They've reported, I'm sorry, they had a meeting last night. The Rosamond Elementary School students, they had the choir sing for the board members. The principals gave their reports. The only thing that's upcoming that I could think of off the top of my head is there will be a competition between some students at West Park and some students at Rosamond Elementary for a chef contest, and that'll be in March. And that's hosted by Sodexo, which is the people who provide the food for the students. And this is Community Café.
Ah,
okay. Hey, how you folks doing?
Well, you're a featured speaker. That's cool. Why don't we finish up with our community leader reports, and then we'll go back to...
just one question on the school district, though.
Go ahead.
Did they break ground at Rosamond Elementary?
They did.
And did they take a shovel out? Or did you see them actually move the bulldozer?
I didn't see a bulldozer or anything, but the... superintendent of the construction company came to the last meeting, which was in the beginning of the month, and he was just saying that he was excited to work with the community and the school district again.
You haven't looked at a picture of any broken ground?
Not yet. No.
Okay. Thank you very much. Antelope Valley Citizens for Responsible Use of Water.
Yeah, a few things. First, we're still in a drought. Although the rains and the snow in Northern California have helped a bit, the reservoirs are up a bit. The allocation to all the state water contractors currently is 15% of their normal allocation, which for AVEC will allow them to satisfy all their customer needs and actually have a little bit of water left over, partly because they've got carryover from previous years.
Randy, they don't settle on a final number until April, right?
Right. In fact, you know, it could go up. There's some speculation. There's a lot of opinions on El Nino and so on, but if it were to go up to, like, for instance, 20%, which people seem to think that, you know, probably be a reasonable thing that it may go up to, but, you know, there's a lot of speculation on that. So,
is there any way you could figure out, Judge Kumar in December 23rd adjudication said, $150 an acre foot that AVIC gets the raw water for, that's what the dormant land and unit owners, that's a pretty reasonable price. You can get it all day. If AVEC's met all of its allocations at 15%, does it have surplus water? Does that sell for less than $150 an acre foot? And if so, how much less?
I don't know the answer to that question. I can tell you they are looking at exchanges with other agencies. There are other agencies that even at 15% throughout the state of California, you know, there's 27 state water contractors. Some of the others would not be able to meet their allocation. So they are looking at exchanges, which is actually a good thing. It's kind of like loaning water to someone else. They pay you back, and actually AVEC is able to obtain money for doing that and so on. So
places like maybe the Southern South San Joaquin Valley there.
Yeah, then there's a number of them. They're looking at the one with the Metropolitan Water District and so on. So they are able to exchange, and you can do that by different throughout the state of California. You know, you can take it out of the aqueduct one place and get somebody gets credit for another place and so on. So they're looking at doing that. They're also looking at, of course, their water banking, putting more water in the banks. They actually bought some more property, 20 acres at Avenue Fairmont area, Avenue B and 285th West, that they said they've done some look at.
AVEC bought it at 285th Street West and Avenue B?
Right, Avenue B. 20 acres for a potential water bank, and they're developing the water bank that they bought, if I remember right, it's 80 acres out in between about 96th and 106th East, and they've been working on that one for quite some time now, too.
80 acres up by East?
Yeah, on their east side.
Avenue J or where?
Oh, no, it's near Avenue T and U, out in that area. Not very far from, in fact, it's very close to the aqueduct.
That would make more sense.
Yep. Okay. Let's see. One of the things, Danny Bazell, who is Senator Runner's field representative, announced at the meeting that on Saturday, April the 2nd, from 10 to 12 o'clock, there'll be, Senator Runner will be holding a public water forum, which is the status of water in California, basically anything to do with water, at the Palmdale Library or Chimboli Center. They hadn't set that up yet. Talk about water conservation, banking, reservoir status, and everything else.
Every what day?
Saturday, April 2nd, from 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock. I would imagine if someone hasn't heard or hasn't read about in the paper or whatever, if you just go to probably Senator Runner's website, they should be able to tell you, because that's who's sponsoring it.
Okay.
One other thing that's got going on, they've had two meetings, two public meetings, one in January and the other one was yesterday at Lancaster City Hall on discussion of water master organization. There's going to be five members for that board, two members, AVEC and Waterworks, LA County Waterworks 40 have been identified. Then the second public water supplier member will be identified, and then two landowner members must be elected. The meeting they had yesterday is the second of the parties to the judgment to discuss progress in establishing the Water Master board members.
Who's the LA County District 40 member?
I don't know.
They said he was elected? Or is he?
No, if you let me finish this. This is an announcement of discussion of the Water Master organization, okay? The public water suppliers will discuss their progress in selecting representation for the Water Master board. In addition, the landowners will discuss their election process status. This meeting will provide an opportunity for the parties to the judgment to express their opinion regarding the Water Advisory Committee as envisioned by the stipulating parties. Other parties to the judgment are encouraged to forward topics for discussion that would assist in establishing the representatives of the Water Master board or other matters of interest to the group. So it's public meetings. They held the second one yesterday. I wasn't able to go to it, but I seriously doubt that would have been the last one. So I'm sure there's going to be more of these.
Oh, this meeting was held yesterday, and you don't have the next meeting date then?
No, I don't. They held the first one in January. The second one was yesterday. The one from January and the notice of this one were on the AVEC website, which is avec.org, and the I believe the slides and maybe even a transcript, I'm not sure, but at least the slides were available from the January meeting on the AVEC website. So the February one, which was only held yesterday, I don't know if the slides are available yet, but people can look on there, and then I would recommend looking on there to find out when the next one is going to be too. But it sounds like there's going to be a series of these the purpose being to primarily establish the members of the board and how they're going to elect those and so on and so forth. And then it says other matters of interest to the group. And everyone in the Antelope Valley virtually is a party to the adjudication one way or the other, or represented by other organizations.
Missing Dennis? Allison, anything going on in for
Okay, that'll do it for our community announcements. Then I think what we'll do is we'll invert the schedule and we'll go to our guest speakers here from the Rosamond Community Café.
All right. Mm-hmm. Ourselves. We are radish.org. My name is Eric Miller. I'm one of the board members for radish.org. This is Crystallyn Rodriguez. Crystallyn is actually from the Rosamond community. And first of all, we'd like to thank you guys for inviting us to come speak. Our chairman, Jamie Shively, couldn't make it today. We're all in travels. Actually, me and Crystal just got back from Spain not too long ago, about a couple of weeks ago. And what we do is we're a global transformation group for trying to make change in communities. So what we do is we take private sector corporations. Like myself, I have a water business. And I also was in the entertainment business, where I work with celebrities, and this is where me and Crystal work together. And what we try to do is bring the community and finances together to make change. And one of the first changes that we try to do, and Crystal was the one that directed our attention here to Rosamond. Because everybody, first thing our partners said, well, where's Rosamond? And so we said, well, ask Crystalyn, because this is where she's from. And she introduced us to Terry for the Parade of Lights, and that was our first model of trying to see how Community Café could actually work. Community Café is where we bring the community together to have meals three times a day. And so we offer meals for free, but what happens is the private sector pays for those meals in order to bring the communities together. And so our first company that we had was a corporation out of Japan called Sato Hemp. They're a clothing company that decided, they say, well, we want to give 100% of our profits towards what you guys are doing. I wanted to do the same thing with my water business as well as part of my entertainment groups, but most of those people said, not 100%, Eric, we'll do, you know, we'll donate, but we won't give 100% of our profits because that breaks the model of why you're in business in the first place. And that's why radish.org came into existence in the first place. We're trying to break that mold to say the community needs, it needs more support. They need help. They need to be able to say, how are we going to work together to solve all these problems? Whether it's hunger, whether it's homelessness, whether it's the, you know, whether it's, you know, climate control, whatever the issue is, we work towards those issues. But our first one is actually tackling hunger, because that's something that we've traveled all over the world. We found out that is a global issue all over the world. It's not something just happens in, and I'm from Bronx, New York. It's not something that just happens in New York. It doesn't happen just in LA. It doesn't just happen, she's originally from Spain. It just doesn't happen in her country. So it happens all over the world. So we said, how do we find something that everybody can get behind? And hunger was the first thing that we all could figure out as private sector groups to say, we can all agree with that. And so that's when we said, okay, let's figure out what is it that we want to target. So we said, let's go community cafes. And we call it that because, again, it allows the community to come in, sit down with each other, three meals a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. When we said, how do we build a model? Rosamond, when we talked with Terry, one thing we noticed about you guys' area was that you have a lot of land, for one. And you also had a good throughway into Los Angeles, because first thing everybody wanted to do was go right into Los Angeles. The problem with Los Angeles is it's already saturated, too many politics, and whatever money you wind up putting into it, it doesn't wind up going to the community. I've tried it before in different things that I've worked in, and the people who needed the money never got it. So we said, where is a place we can start a model to where the people actually get to benefit from what we're trying to do? We can take that model and take it on a global scale. So in doing the research here, which we're still doing, and looking at Rosamond, we said, how do we build this out and create a model that we say, not only do the city of Rosamond, are they proud about it, and say we're the first compassionate group that said we want to take something on a global scale, but also how is it something that you guys can be, can appreciate and say this is something that we actually, you know, want to have a stamp of approval on. So this is one reason we want to come in, find out who are the leaders here in the group, in the communities, and try to work with you all to figure out what is the solution and what's the best way we can put this together with our backing, with our ideas, and something that you guys may want for your community towards a compassionate city, and then creating a model that we can take on a global scale. So one thing that me and Crystal have been doing, like I said, is traveling, going from different cities. So we're not just focusing on just America. Like I said, we're going different countries and seeing what is something that you guys can get behind. If the private sector said we want to put money behind it, and who would be the leaders to say we're not going to let this group come in and not allow the community to take advantage of it? So it's not something, it's not a government initiative, it's not something that we're not some, you know, group that's behind the scenes that are not, we're very transparent. Everything that we do, we want everybody to know what we're doing at all times. Because again, this is all about the community, how to build it up, how to take the finances that we build, whether it's from Hollywood or whether it's from the local community, merge them all together so that way everybody wins. So this is pretty much how we're building this model out. Right now, we're launching two private sector businesses, which is one is the clothing business, in which we take clothing and we call it compassion and fashion. So we create clothing brands that will go up against your major brand clothing companies and give people a choice. Would you rather put your money here, or would you rather put your money towards compassion and fashion,
in which your money goes 100% into the community cafes. And people get to see that money right there in their own communities and start seeing it grow. So that is the models that we're working on right now that we're launching. I know you guys want to see, well, how are you guys going to build this out and who's going to be involved? Those are things that we want to sit down with the community leaders like yourselves and find out what are ways we can work together. You know, how do we take our initiatives and the things that we're working on, whether it's all the finances that we're putting together and also the vision that we have, and merge it with what you guys would like to see in your cities. So that's part of why we're here tonight. We wish Jamin was here, because Jamin is primarily the visionary behind this whole thing. I'm normally the guy behind the scenes. You really never see me. I'm normally the operating guy, so I'm always on the go. But I'm the one that generally get behind. When he tells me this is what we want to do, I'm the target guy. I'm the one that shoots the bullet. So that's pretty much how we normally work. But we just wanted to make sure we actually showed up tonight to be able to say, at least let's begin the talks and see exactly what exactly you guys would like to see from us, and see if there is a synergy that we can create here to build that model for global transformation.
What's your name again?
Eric Miller.
But and Crystallyn
Rodriguez.
Rodriguez. Yeah. And Eric Miller? Is that Eric Miller's son? Crazy.
Terry told me that.
Norm Miller's son, yeah.
Yes. Could be family somewhere down the road. Yes, sir.
I have a question. I also read an article, I think it was in the local Mojave Desert News, and I may have misinterpreted the word build, because it almost sounded like something was going to be built, but you are talking about, like, it sounds like creating jobs with the clothing. And what's the advantages? Obviously, it's a good advantage to give people meals that need them, but are there additional potential advantages to the local community as far as jobs and things like that, or manufacturing things? Or
absolutely. One of the things that we're doing with the community cafes is we want to create portable cafes.
That's what I thought I was talking about, building something.
Right. Yeah. So the portable cafes, my experience is I'm ex-military, retired law enforcement. I was SWAT instructor for Monterey County. I'm right out of Monterey County. But I did a lot of disaster relief, a lot of things like that. So my experience was, when things go wrong, people need something that can pop up quick. Matter of fact, in Monterey, we had the fires, and there were over 20,000 people out of their homes. This was just in September.
Okay.
Yes. Up towards Big Sur area and down below. And these people were pretty much, the community tried to come together to try to put up tents, try to do things, but then there was areas we couldn't get into to help these people. So we start, you know, that was one of the things that we talked about, was pop-ups as far as community cafes, where there will be trailers that can go out into areas. One of the areas we're looking at were Haiti. We weren't just wanting to focus on third world countries, but we knew those were immediate needs. The things we had, and I have a lot of contacts there, Jamin does too, the problems that we saw in those countries, especially Africa, all those third world countries, the community cafe wasn't built just for third world countries. They were built for communities. That was the vision that we had. That's the vision that we had for this whole thing. So it's not just for impoverished nations, but it's for communities to come together and start building together. And we figured the easiest thing people can do is provide a good meal for each other. That's the most simplest thing we can do. We can afford to do it in this society. We just don't do it because everybody's focused on whatever their issues are and whatever they want to. But that is initially what we want to do, is build out trailers that can go out and work as if there's not a brick and mortar opportunity we can put in areas. We want to be able to use those portable community cafes to pop up in cities and say, you know, here's something that you guys can utilize, whether it's temporary until we build a brick and mortar. But I looked at it from a disaster relief opportunity that you can hurry up and put up, whether it's Hurricane Katrina, things of those natures, that you can just go ahead and put in those areas and hurry up, implement, and get people feeding and get people served and getting their dignity back, whatever happens in those areas. So yeah, that's what we initially want to do, if we can start it here. So that's something that the finance and the economics will go towards. and that is jobs as well.
Well, the seniors can be fed for a very reasonable price here. I think at noon it's right here in the fall, Monday through Friday.
Right.
Crystallyn, you graduated from Rosamond High School there?
Yeah, 08.
08. Well, since that time we've got a new superintendent that every child who's involved in preschool, before school activity, and of course during lunch and after school activity, gets free meal. That's, so I don't know if that competes with you or that, but that
not at all.
Dovetails with you, but that's something that's been implemented.
Okay.
I guess the question is, are you going to have like a super roach coach is what you're going to have to do the food, or are you going to?
I think it's
And you're going to have like a clothing place where you can put people to work to build up these items of.
The textiles are actually being made in Japan, so that's a designer brand that's going to be made. That's one brand that's going to be made, but we're looking to do other brands just to, because that's one decided. That company was already in place; they had already been around for over 10 years, and so they said, "But I'm willing to give 100% of our profits, of course, after we pay all our expenses. But we're willing to give 100% of our profits to get things kickstarted." So then we started finding other companies that said, I'll do this, I'm willing to do the same thing. If that company will do it, I'll match that. So we started saying, okay, how do we start also building our own economic engine, which would be companies that actually compete. So say if it's an iPhone, okay, we give people a choice. Now we create opportunities to build those technologies out so people can still have the technologies that you're used to using, but we give you an option. What if you had this brand here, brand A, that gives 100% of their profits towards community cafes, but Apple doesn't give 100% to anything other than to their own pockets. So we want to give people that option. So part of that is creating that environment to where you can do that. So it would be a manufacturer for certain products and goods to be able to do that 100% profit opportunity. I'm not sure if I have that.
I guess I'd have to see the business model.
Absolutely.
Does he have one laid out even, or does he?
We're still designing that because we've got to figure out Santil Hemp and this other brand that we're building right now. That's going to tell us how to go ahead and scale that out.
It's been mentioned though. You're feeding like you did. Thank you very much by the way for the December 5th feed.
Absolutely.
That was very nice. But if you're feeding folks, that's going to attract folks who can't care for themselves.
Absolutely.
That maybe enjoy a lifestyle where we're not hide anything but a sleeping bag in a bush. Mm-hmm. But sometimes that's, you know, they need mental health services. If you looked in the back, you might need mental health services for folks.
Actually, we have. There's a model Roosevelt.
Pasadena
already has a model that they use on a monthly basis. To where they do shower points. They also do amnesty because most of their homeless situations and people who have those problems, they know they have minor infractions. So they set up shower points, they set up job opportunities, they do feeding, but they only do it ever so often. They try to do it about once a month, but it's a lot of times based on the finances that they have coming in. So my partner's over there, said, well, Eric, we already have this model in place, but we want to sit down and talk with you. How do we build this out? And I said, well, we want to work on a city that we want to start building a relationship with, but we'll start partnering with those cities like Pasadena to utilize those models that they have in place for mental health, for arrest situations where they try to, like I said, to create an amnesty situation to clear those things so people can get jobs, especially if they have they just build up minor infractions after minor infractions, and part of it is their homeless, their economic situation, and they just keep getting in trouble for some of the smallest things, but it builds out. And so, when you do offer things like that, you do draw, you will have I envision that there will be that group who do come in, the backpackers and the homeless situation, that they will, but we try to make sure that we create services around that circumstance as well to take advantage when they do show up to say, what other help do you need? So we can start answering those concerns as well. So the city, so as a city, you guys don't get that huge influx of people coming in.
Well, in Antelope Valley too, the number one area that you refer a homeless person to or someone who's needed getting back on it would be Grace Resource Center in Lancaster. Have you contacted any of the people over there to talk to them?
Have not talked with anybody in Lancaster yet in regards to that. But those are the things, again, we want to sit down with you guys to figure out what is the best situation for you based on things that we envision. Because we're just stepping in and we want to offer our services and what we're trying to build here to see if this is something that works for this city. You know, even though we feel like it's a great model to go by, but it has to work with the community being involved and putting you guys' input as well as your concerns on the table.
Now, in terms of workplace, could you expand on that a little bit as to how you would accomplish that and where it would work?
In regards to like jobs,
homeless.
Like employment?
Homeless. We have quite a bit of homeless in our area.
Right.
And our biggest concern is not to attract more homeless.
Absolutely.
And if we do, they should be placed in long-term care. I mean, at least supervision of some kind.
Right.
For proper direction. And part of that would be to get them to work, but and not just hang around our streets.
Right.
Because that is an issue.
Okay.
And to provide a community cafe to where we're just attracting more homeless and we're just loitering everywhere with no activity whatsoever versus, you know, I like the mental health idea, of course, but we also got to put them in action and do the work. You know, get them motivated, have them have an initiative to do something. Otherwise, they're just going to hang around the community itself here and just do what they do.
Absolutely. Great question. I think that's something, again, we'd have to sit down with the community and figure out what's the effects that this creates. By trying to create one circumstance, does this create an effect that you don't want to see? And if it is, how do we mitigate that? How do we, you know, as far as the job side, we're looking at, when we talk about building out the community cafes or the portables, those are going to be, of course, you know, it can be labor jobs that are minuscule to the point to where just putting bolts together in a compact situation or packaging. So there will be opportunities for those, for, you know, non-skilled workers as well as for skilled workers to come in and have things to do. But if like you said, if there's the hard to serve are showing up and they also need housing, they may need, whether they need, you know, other things other than being fed, then we'd have to try to attack that as a community to figure out what are those things that we need to put in place with that circumstance. So it's not a point of just feeding. You guys have the concern of also the loitering side or just drawing more traction, or I would have to look at, you guys have access to the highway, so that does bring a lot of traffic to your area. So how do you create a community, a compassionate community, without having a situation when everybody floods this area and not have something that they can actually, you guys cannot be proud of what your community have turned into. So it's going to be a lot of what you guys, the feedback you guys give us on how we move forward or proceed forward to make sure we don't infringe on something that you have in place or create another issue that you weren't looking for. So that's going to be important for us.
Well, I think feeding is a great thing. However, you got to put them to work too.
Absolutely.
You just can't have feeding alone because they have no initiative to work through.
Yes. Gotcha.
So I mean, that's really a key element. And I apologize on the call. When you're talking about manufacturing, was that here or overseas?
That would be here.
Here.
The portable community cafes, we want to do that here in Rosamond. Once we can figure out how to create, whether it's to buy the land, to work with the city to see what you guys would need us to be put in place in order to put that all together.
So So let's say a homeless comes in, you'd be willing to put them work manufacturing on site?
Absolutely. Or at least get them to the point to where they're at a dignity point, to where we build them up to say, okay, let's get your backgrounds cleaned up, because it's not just about just putting them to work. It's also straightening. There's a lot of issues that hard to serve also have, whether it's mental health, whether it's, like I said, you may have warrants that, you know, that may be ongoing. There's things that these folks could be running from that we also may need to address as a community. So we want to make sure we address those as well.
You mean like coupling, like some rehabilitation for them?
Yes.
Do you want to take a break? Maybe we can talk with him on that, or just want to move on to the next slide?
I'm ready to move on.
Any other questions?
No, I just wanted to introduce ourselves. And
well, let's just stick around after the meeting. We'll talk to you.
Absolutely. Thanks, Mr.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Thank you.
It said it will take place from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the city's development services parking lot, which is on Sierra Highway at the corner of Q11. Spay and neuter pricing will be $60 for cats, $100 for dogs. Low-income residents may qualify for a $50 voucher. Price includes a physical exam by a licensed vet, surgery, pain meds, follow-up phone call, and for dogs, a rabies vaccination and microchip. It says to schedule an appointment for spaying or neutering, call 855-499-LUCY, or you can email them at info@lucypetfoundation.org. And it says no appointment is needed for vaccinations. So it sounds like a good thing if someone would like to take advantage of that.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else?
We have an air show coming up next week. Our next meeting is in March.
The air show is the 19th and 20th, or that weekend.
So the day after our next meeting. So we got the Blue Angels. Blue Angels are the headliners. If I could hear Fast Planes up close and personal, LA County Air Show at Fox Field, March 18th, 19th, and 20th. It's 19th and 20th. So Thursday, Friday?
Saturday, Sunday.
Today's the 18th.
Okay, so that closes out our community announcements, unless somebody else has anything they want to share. All right, public comment period. Anybody want to rant for the next 3 minutes on something that's anything that's on their mind? Anybody? Everybody just happy. Surely I thought Bill was going to say something. No, I'm kidding. All right.
Set it for a different number.
Okay, our business meeting here. Okay, moving on down the agenda, we have under the heading of business meeting, our standing committee reports, which will be the planning committee, which will be Bill. Ms. Romo's not here, and myself. I don't have any comments.
Yeah, I have nothing from the planning committee for this meeting.
Oh, no, you're not, so you. Okay, I don't either. As far as safety, that's, Dan Spohr is no longer here.
Did he resign, or what happened?
He resigned. He sent a letter to,
Yeah, I have it on the agenda later.
We can't really accept it right now because we're not meeting tonight, or what?
Well, yeah, well, it's accepted. He sent it to Supervisor Scriven. And I think he sent it to Dennis, too.
They moved.
It's just a matter of basically kind of announcing that there is a position open, so if anyone wants to apply.
Can you announce that then? How does someone apply, and what do they need to do?
Yeah, just go to the Kern County website. You click on the little link. It's on the middle right side of the page. It says boards, commissions, and committees.
Boards, commissions, and committees.
And there's just a general form that you fill out to apply, and you'll basically write in what board it is for. So it's the same form that you would do for kind of any of the board's commissions or committees. And then the board of supervisors will appoint one of the applicants. They may want to interview them depending on how many there are. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Ron. Public health.
Crystallyn used to live in Rosamond?
I'm sorry?
Do you still live in Rosamond?
I still live in Rosamond.
So Crystallyn could apply too, right?
Yes. Okay. Anyone, if they anyone on RMAC boundaries, he doesn't have a conflict of interest.
And our boundaries go from Edwards Air Force Base to 175th Street West, Avenue A to Don Road. Mm-hmm. That's something I'm planning to maybe have to keep in mind.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is public health and safety, which would be myself, Schaffner, and Landsgaard. I don't have anything on that. And never have.
Yeah, you should. But in the meantime, where you
never have. Somehow somebody put me on that committee. I can't remember who.
Well, hopefully we'll have some more information for you soon to work on. We do have, obviously, the Community Café is related to public health. And we have the, one of these days we're going to hospital up here. If you work on it, what do you think? Heard you care so?
Possibly.
Okay.
All right, Public Works Committee, that would be Bill.
Okay. I've heard quite a bit about the construction that's going to start at Rosamond Elementary School and how it's going to impact Rosamond Boulevard. But there hasn't been anything put out on that. And Ryan, it would be nice if we could get some kind of indication of what kind of street improvements are going to be done in concert with the expansion of Rosamond Elementary School. Specifically entrance and exit points for the school campus, how it impacts upon the AM/PM market there, how it impacts the traffic coming off of the freeway, as well as how it might impact the traffic going into or out of Edwards Air Force Base.
And setting up alternate routes perhaps too. I guess if you're going to go most of the traffic coming from Lancaster might want to get off and out of the way and come up Sierra Highway. I've noticed that every once in a while I have to come in at 7 o'clock in the morning or around 7:30 in the morning getting on the Rosen Boulevard. There's gridlock, which is something you don't experience in Rosenberg out there. You simply just don't want to be on the road. If I go to the overpass, I take go by Foster's and I go south to go where I need to go because that place is it's just jam-packed with vehicles, and that's without construction. Mm-hmm. So we really need to look at, maybe Bill, you're going to work on this with Ryan during the next month. What's it going to take to develop an Apple A turn up on Sierra Highway and perhaps improve a left turn lane at Avenue A and Sierra Highway? That's just a sharp lane. If you could expand it out, make it a little easier to turn left or right, that would be good. Maybe add a pocket coming south. So you could have a right turn lane coming off of Sierra Highway. Could you write that down before I forget about it?
I've got those covered in my notes.
Yeah, because that would be the obvious alternate route. The other obvious route is the not so obvious alternate route. Would be if one we've been crying for a long time is to put the Don Road half a mile that we're lacking between Sierra Highway and the freeway. If we could put that, if we could pave that, people can go up Sierra Highway to there and go across, but they have to come all the way back down. I don't think they'd do that.
If someone's looking at the traffic flow on Rosamond Boulevard, they ought to address the longstanding issue of the exit off the freeway.
Yeah.
Northbound exit onto Rosamond Boulevard that hits
well, it's
east.
It's so hard if you try to like get up, turn left on Blood
yeah.
Tower.
Yeah,
get up the freeway,
and people will stop at the off ramp.
You got to go two lanes over in about 20 feet. Yeah.
But we brought that up, you know, I think it was when Mr. Pope was here and so on. But someone should take, if you're going to take a look at the traffic flow in that area, that ought to encompass that part of it too.
I'm suggesting that during the construction, perhaps between 6:30 in the morning and 8:30 in the morning, unless it's during school, through traffic got to be getting off and out of the road, coming up right going around.
Well, rather than engineer it here, we ought to get the county road engineers involved to look at that whole flow, and if they're going to look at
yeah, well, the long run's going to have to change.
But somebody's got to do something about
that.
Exactly.
Yeah. I don't think we have a program yet for next month, do we?
If not, I understand Ken Green wants wants to bring his comfort dog.
And, oh, okay.
Is that on the, that should be on the agenda? I don't think about,
no.
Have you heard the speech?
Oh yeah, he was here, but I don't know if we have him, do we have him planned to be on the agenda for a specific month?
Yeah, we can ask him to come to a specific month, so bring his comfort dog and we'll hear the speech.
I just didn't know if you wanted to try to get the roads people out.
Definitely get the roads people
out. Because they haven't been out here probably since middle of last year.
But you might propose to them something, whether it's in a letter or whatever, to look at that and then give them the time enough to look at it. It's, you know, it, rather than get them here and try and confront them, I would highly recommend have them plan something and then say when they're ready to come back with a plan or address all the public concerns, then that would be appropriate for
that's why I'm asking the question about the plans for the elementary school, because I haven't seen anything, and I'm wondering if the Zach's office has seen anything on this elementary school job and how it impacts Rosamond Boulevard.
Well, depending on what, it, you know, the scope of the construction, they would have had to get certain permits from the county to do those, to do that work. So I'm not sure, you know, I haven't seen it. But that's because that wouldn't come through our office, but I can access that. I can find out.
Would it be okay if I contact Greg Pope direct?
Craig, so you probably want to contact the planning department, is who I would assume, for roads, or even
do contact Greg Pope, and then he can...
Yeah, you can contact him if you'd like, but I can find out for you as well, send it over.
Well, I don't think there's a reason why, well, check and see if Ken Green can make it for the 18th, or the 17th, I mean, we got to find out the market decisions here.
I don't have any contact information for him. Usually, Dennis would contact
We'll ask Dennis.
And the reason why I'm trying to elevate this a little bit, Ryan, is typically you have haul routes that you set up for those trucks that are going to be moving in and out, either bringing in fill dirt or taking out and exporting soil from the school site. You have delivery vehicles. It's going to have to be regulated and timed in such a way that it does not interfere with morning or evening traffic coming off the base at Edwards Air Force Base. And I haven't seen anything on haul routes at all. And that leads me to believe that maybe the development is strictly within the boundaries of Rosamond Elementary School and no consideration has been done as far as roads go.
Okay.
Which would be the worst situation we could find ourselves in.
My understanding is when Mr. Weinstein spoke about a year ago here to us, he talked about taking and Glendower, and it's going to get bigger. They're going to slice out a lane, basically a lane of travel east of where Glendower goes up now, and that's going to be where the buses go in. And if they're going to have a right turn lane, they're actually going to slice out on the north side of Rosamond Boulevard to make that a right turn lane. That would be helpful to know. And that's probably something that should happen first, I guess. Is that
yeah,
right?
Well, the haul routes actually should already be in place now, because you're going to have to get that traffic away from the freeway. You're going to have to get it away from that intersection there in Glendower. It's got to come in from the backside, either off Sea or a highway,
which you could
into
do.
The
yeah.
school.
Well, that's something I could find out if anything was done through the county, but if there wasn't, then it's something you'll have to take up with the school district.
Okay, so we are the county, this board.
Yeah.
And we're going to have to go to the school district. Do you want us to do that, or do you want to do
that?
Well, no, as representative?
Well, I can find out if they apply for permits or anything like that to the county. Bill's saying he doesn't think that they need to do
it. Well, somebody just needs to pick up the phone and talk to the superintendent, right? Would that be our job then? We could do that.
Whatever you guys want.
Okay, I'll give them the phone. You want me and Bill? Maybe we can
see. Yeah, I'd like to do that, because...
You guys can call on behalf of the RMAC. I don't see why not.
Because traffic is already getting really bad on Rosamond Boulevard in the mornings. I don't know what else you can do to possibly make it any worse. But
it is bad. And that's without any trucks. That's just cars. Mm-hmm. Well, there is a couple of trucks, but yeah.
Okay. Any further discussion on Public Works? Moving on to Public Relations, that's with the Olaf, myself, and Ms. Rosamond. You want to go first, Paul?
Well, thank you everybody for coming out. Thank you, of course, for all the coverage. Maggie Press, Rosamond News.
the, there's the PR for the RMAC, if we can make things a little bit easier for you folks. We are the sounding board, the eyes and ears for the second supervisor, so continue to bring your ideas here to the meetings and we'll continue to get help.
You can also do that too, make your comments on Facebook. There's a page that we have on Facebook. And again, I also would like to thank the media for coming down, as you always do. You're just relentlessly here, and I appreciate that. On a negative note, I'm here to tell you that I cannot make any progress with Charter. They have completely put up a brick wall. They've hurt our commerce. I actually got a refund check for a buy that I had placed through a rep company. And they told me that we were up and running and we could actually run commercials on Charter cable locally. But we seem to be the only area of this county, Kern County, that they do not have any input. They do no insertion in this area. I don't know how they get away with that. There is one person that is in charge. I didn't find that out. They will not give me his name. That's why I say the block comes up. I was told even by Time Warner Cable that we were clear to go ahead, so I went ahead and placed the buy. Again, they said they couldn't insert, can't help you. So if you think, if I can't give them, write them checks, think about this. If I can't write them a check and they won't cash the check, what do you think your chances are of having some kind of community access channel here? If I'm giving them money, they sure aren't going to give you anything for free. So I've done everything I can with regard to trying to get Charter up to speed on serving this community, in addition to it hurts my business because I can't place any buys. We can't do anything in Rosamond, Cal City. Ridgecrest we can, but that doesn't serve my community here. So I don't know who these people are. I know that there is one man that my rep guy, for some reason or other, is just not giving his name or his phone number. And so I don't know who can get through to these people at Charter, but I can't.
Can you get us an address?
I'll give you a phone number to this guy, but it's not. But I'm just saying, I've been doing this now for, what, a year?
We get an address, Mr. Parkman can write a letter, and we can present it to Mr. Schaffner and make previous and see what we can do.
I was just under, unless I'm really outdated, I was just under the impression that any cable company that came through any particular zone, they have a responsibility to provide some kind of access to the community. That was part of their big push to get into communities. We want to become a partner with your community. And I'm not seeing this at all with Charter. Like I said, if they won't take my checks, then I don't see why I'm going to get any free time as far as covering any high school sports. Or doing these meetings. These meetings should be on some kind of a public access channel.
But so two comments on that, if I could, real quickly. One, if I could segue way out and bring it back in. Race Communications, I don't know if you've heard of them, they've brought high access internet cable to Bacchus Road, parts of Mojave Tropical Road. They've also went it out to Desert Lake and Boron. About 3 years ago, Superintendent Weinstein got together with Charter and said, I want high-speed access to my school so I can, you know, have a laptop there for every child, 6th grade to 12th grade, it actually makes sense. And he got them to spend the money, and he spent the money bringing them here. I think it was $50,000. He might have a little poll, so maybe we can add that to our list of things to talk to Mr. Weinstein while we talk to him, okay, Bill, about how Charter works, and maybe Gary, if you want to come along. Okay.
So that's all that's I'm at the end here. So whatever you think we can do to get some kind of coverage here, I'm open for it. So I have not made any progress on it. Okay, moving on to item 11, old business. That's an NA there. Whatever that means, I'm sure not applicable. For new business,
we can't take any food.
Can't do anything because we're not really having a meeting.
Well, what we could do is
I need more people in the middle, so
Well, that's why I said we're not having a meeting.
But what we could do, Gary, since we're talking about Dan's four there, you know, we got the general election coming up in November.
I think
we have at least a couple of board positions that are supposed to come up then for in the November election, I believe.
Well, let's back up a second. Dan's four's position, is it a 2-year or 4-year?
I don't remember.
Was it expiring here at the end of the thing anyway?
I don't think it's.
I think it was a 4-year.
I thought so, but I'll find out.
And then, so if that's the case, we need to get someone appointed. And either way, we need to keep generating interest from the community about people who are interested. Now's a good time to start because we can.
Either way, I don't think Supervisor Scrivener's going to want to keep it vacant for,
Well, actually, if he does keep it vacant, we can appoint.
But he's not going to want to keep it vacant.
That's how we get him to appoint somebody.
He's not going to want to keep it vacant.
And we need to get some interest from the community involved so that they're thinking about it now, because when July rolls around, when you're supposed to sign up to run for election, everybody's on vacation or something, they forget all about it, and you barely get enough people to fill the slots. But if they're thinking about it now, then they'll be thinking about it then. I think that'd be a good thing to get your application. I guess the question is, it's your position, Mr. Representative, for second district supervisor, that Crystallyn and others can immediately fill out an application and apply for the job of the opening of the RMAC director tonight if they want to.
Yep.
And so it said, as far as about possible resignation of director Spores, item B, that's really a moot point. You're telling me this supervisor has already accepted his resignation, is that right?
Yeah.
So we should probably put that in the minutes that if the supervisor has accepted his resignation and applications are being taken. And for those of you who don't know about how RMAC works, and now that Randy, you're in district boundaries, there's seven of us. So in any given year, there's going to be three spots open for the 4-year term. And if Dan was is a 4-year term, whoever gets appointed, they'd have to run for re-election again. That spot will be open again, so there'll be like 3.5 spots open. So at least 3 spots will be open in July to run. That's always a good thing to remember.
Okay. Moving on to item 13, director's agenda referrals, items for new business.
I'd like to see an item on there for us to write a letter concerning the fact that we're short 3 deputies. I'd like to see something on there about writing a letter to Charter Cable. I have a different idea too, but I can't remember what it is. That's my 2 ideas for that anyway.
Okay, so a couple of years of this, and this is my business, and if I can't get to these people, somebody needs to find out who is responsible for this area. Instead of chasing us around.
Well,
I'm really aggravated about it. It's taking up a lot of my time.
I think we should
not get anywhere. Somebody needs to find the name and make something happen.
And you're the guy.
And I am not the guy. I've done everything I can. That's why I keep telling you.
All right, what I normally
I made a public statement tonight that I ran into a brick wall.
What I normally do when I run into a brick wall, like dealing with a claims adjuster or whatever, is just, well, why not write a letter to the president of the insurance company? In this case, who's the president of Charter Cable?
You're not going to get anywhere there.
Who's the president of Charter Cable?
You're not going to go there, Olaf. That's not practical.
Yes, we are going there. You can't get there. We can't.
Okay, well then you will.
No, I'm talking about the Rosa Municipal Library Council. It has a lot more poll with the president of Charter Cable than Gary Thieman does.
Well, that's fine with me. Then you do it, because I've done what
we
I can.
We will do it. If we just need to get us to add name, address, and we'll get it there.
Okay. Make it happen.
Okay. Those are the 2 things I want. Anyway.
Okay. Anybody, any other new business? Items from new business? Okay. Director's comments. Start with Mr. Landsgaard.
Well, thank you, everybody, for coming tonight. I really appreciate the presentation by Community Café. I understand we got a few people ill. We're down a director, but hopefully that'll change here by next month.
forward to seeing you all again next month. And as of next month, will be just before the air show. The weather will be certainly dry. Conference room may be arranging for that. That's going to be the only weekend it's going to be dry in March. And we pray for that. We keep on praying for rain. But the but keep, you know, keep your ideas coming. Really appreciate you doing that. We appreciate, of course, the job that the Rosamond Community Watch. Is it Rosamond Community Watch Foundation? What's the F for? Is it RCW or
RCWP?
Program. Okay. Well, appreciate what they're doing. If you get a chance, you guys could be at across from
Sal's
on at 7:30 Hawk. You'd be doing the weeds until about noon, and that's on Saturday.
Yep.
And you got Guido's serving pizza afterwards. Is that what the deal is?
So I'm not sure on lunch yet.
I'm not sure on lunch yet. Well, you can talk to Eric Miller at the Community Café. He can tell you what excites people. So.
There you go.
Okay.
And Cafe with Guido Wing too.
Okay, Bill, any comments?
Just that El Nino's not over with. Make sure your drains are clear. All those good things. If you've got any loose dirt, you might want to take and throw some vinyl or some type of plastic sheeting over it so that it doesn't wash it away and cause you a problem somewhere else, either in your yard or in your neighbor's yard. I know a lot of folks have basically discounted it, but I have a feeling that it's Mother Nature lulling us into a false sense of security. That's all I have.
Okay, I would like to thank Eric Miller and also Crystal Rodriguez for coming and sharing your concerns about our community. We appreciate you coming by. Thank you very much. And I also would like to thank Terry from the Chamber of Commerce. I think some of the people that really go, the Rosamond Community Watch, and also the cleanup, it always baffles me. I mean, I'm glad to see that you guys are really in existence and working hard at it. I see it on the website, the Facebook page every now and then. And that says a lot, but it still amazes me that when you drive down Sierra Highway, you see this trash still. I'm thinking, wow, I mean, I wish there was a way that we could, you know, punish people that are doing that somehow. I mean, it seems like people do it with impunity. It's almost on purpose. I don't understand that kind of behavior.
Well, there is the Ravens getting into the trash.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought it was director's comments. I thought
sorry.
I was speaking.
Go ahead.
I want to thank Olaf for interrupting me through the entire meeting. I couldn't get along without him, but I could. Not because I love Olaf. But anyway, thank you all. Most important, thanks for taking the time to care enough about your community to show up tonight. Okay. And so then that way, I guess we really don't need a motion to do anything since we really haven't had a meeting, correct? So we just adjourn?
Well, we're going to adjourn anyway.
Okay.
We're not here.
No.
You're going to adjourn, you've done
so. Okay. But I just want to hit the gavel that I don't have.
Anyway.
Okay.
The information we brought from RMAC today was primarily just given them kind of creating a welcome between the community and what we want to do at Magic Hour and the Community Cafe. Part of what we wanted to do was explain who we were as Radish.org and what is our function in regards to working with private sector corporations and to creating the community cafes and bringing them to the community. We wanted to see who were the leaders here at RMAC and figure out how do we work together and at least create the conversation to figure out what is it, how is what our vision is for Rosamond going to work together with the city of Rosamond. And there were great questions from the board, as well as from the local community, that some things we hadn't even looked at, to be honest with you. And it was great to hear those things, and we look forward to talking more with the board to figure out how to answer those questions and also how to work together to bring our vision here to Rosamond.
For the Rosamond residents who didn't make it tonight, where can they put their input?
Oh, great question. Definitely go on radish.org and join the conversation. We welcome everybody. We're very transparent. We look forward to getting these ideas because, just like I said, the questions that were asked tonight, those were great questions. Our initiative was primarily to go out and feed the community, but people brought other concerns that actually coincide with feeding. When you got hard to serve people that come in to eat, it's just not about one community, but it's also the homeless, it's different mental health. There's a lot of people that come into that circumstance that the community we have pretty much a concern of how to redirect that traffic after people have eaten. So those are things that we may not have fully addressed, but now we have to make sure that's a main concern for us.
And to my understanding, we're supposed to be having some type of community cafe meetings here for the community. Do you have any idea of when or where that will take place?
We still
got a plan on that. Yes. So that is going to be Crystal's part to put that together. However, we'll be giving her the time frames in regards to the actual businesses, because that's our first objective, is lining up the private sector businesses that will be creating the economic engine to be able to fund all these things. So we're looking at within the next 2 to 3 months to where we have a great plan together with those companies that want to donate the proceeds towards building the community cafe. So that is our driving force, of course, is the financing from those corporations. So once we have those things laid out, then we can tell Crystal, okay, let's start getting on the calendar and saying this is when we're going to start doing this.
Great. And is there anything that you'd like to let the community know?
We're excited about coming here to the Rosamond community. We think you guys have a wonderful community. We look forward to making it, helping you guys become one of the first compassionate cities from a global, and we want people to look at this from a global perspective, because what we're doing is a global initiative. So it's not just something that we're just doing here in the U.S. This is a worldwide initiative that we're reaching out to try to end hunger by 2020. And we need everybody's help to do it. And their support. So again, join the conversation on radish.org. And we're excited to be and honored to be here with you guys, and look forward to doing more with you.
Thank you so much.